reaches the Duponts, and, as if summoned up by his decision, those ponies still on the hill step forward from the dense mist, emerging as if spirits from some ghostly realm. Kai stands still and lets them approach him. They are youngsters and sniff nervously, necks stretched long, ears alert, ready to whip round and tear away should a threat present itself. Which it does, in the wet and panting form of Bracken, who has at last found his master, and comes barking through the miasma, scattering the snorting ponies. Despite himself, Kai laughs, and stoops to ruffle the soggy fur of his corgi. "Now then, Bar," he says, "you'd best save your energy. There'll be more than enough work for you to do this year." He knows the truth of this. Kai watches the skittish youngsters disappearing back into the slowly rising cloud, and a realisation comes to him. The person most suited to herding the flighty little horses on the long journey is Morgana. He stands up, shaking his head at how convoluted are the twists of fate that life delivers. He has only this morning admitted to himself that his wife is a woman apart, a creature full of mystery and miracles. And here he is, planning to enlist her help on a 3-week drove that will make or break the farm and any possible future together they might have. "Dewch," he bids the dog on his heel, and together they start to descend. His chosen route takes him to the lane on the far side of the hill, so that he will have a steady hour's walk home still. He is in the act of climbing the neatly laid hedge onto the road when he hears hooves nearby. There is no cloud at this level, so that he can clearly see the small, raggedy funeral procession as it makes its way along the lane towards the old chapel at Llanwist. Kai steps out of the way and takes his hat from his head as they pass. The cortege is strangely silent, save for the steady hoofbeats of the hairy-heeled horse and the slow creaking of the wheels of the old cart it pulls. The coffin is small and plain. Ahead of the deceased, a minister Kai does not recognise leads the way. There are 4 men following in tall hats, and these he takes to be pallbearers. There is a handful of mourners, no more than 6 in all, 2 of them elderly shuffling women. The sombre party drifts quietly on. Kai feels a chill travel up his spine and puts it down to the damp of the morning getting into his bones. He waits a respectful moment before continuing in the other direction, following the lane toward Tregaron. He has not gone half a mile when he comes across a farmer of advanced years mending a gap in the hedge. For all his age, he is able to deftly raise the short-handled chopper and split the hazel branches before bending them to weave a tight seal for the hole. Kai recognises him as Dai the Forge's uncle. They exchange pleasantries and pass the time of day for a few moments before Kai thinks to ask about the funeral. "I had not heard that someone had died," he says. "Do you know who they're burying up at Llanwist today?" The old man's eyes widen and he stares hard at Kai. "There's not been a funeral up at the old chapel for years," he tells him slowly. "Not since Reverend Williams moved to the coast." "Well, there's one there this morning," Kai assures him. "You must have seen it come past. I had to step out of the way to let it go by, see?" The old man has paled noticeably. He shakes his head. "I saw no funeral," he says. Kai is puzzled and not in the mood for nonsense. "Well, do you'd have been asleep in the hedge not to notice. Big ugly horse they had pulling the cart. Smart enough bearers, mind proper top hats. The mourners were not many or young, but..." The old man repeats slowly. "I saw no funeral, and no more did you." "Are you saying I'm a liar?" "I'm saying you are mistaken." "Don't be daft, man. I know what I saw. How can I mistake a whole funeral?" The old man points with his hatchet as he speaks to underline his words. "I'm telling you, they don't hold funerals up at Llanwist no more, and not a horse, nor a cart, nor a coffin went by here today." He leans forward, his walnut face screwed up, his voice low. "What you saw was a toily." "A toily?" Kai laughs nervously. "Have you been supping ale for breakfast, Grandad?" "Aye, call me a fool or a drunk if it makes you feel easier about it, but there's no getting by the facts." "Facts, is it? You were telling me I've nearly had my toes trod on by a load of ghosts, and you're talking about facts." For Kai has heard of a toily before, many years ago when he was no more than a boy. He remembers his grandfather telling him of how Jones Haildraw recognised a spectral funeral, horses with black feather plumes and all, over near Pontry Digiad, one bright August afternoon. No one would believe him. Kai recalls hearing how the man had been scared half out of his wits and was adamant about what he'd seen. The hedger goes back to chopping at the hazel branches to finish his repairs. No good denying it, he says, not bothering to look at Kai anymore as he speaks. Not for us to decide these things. A toily comes as a message from the spirits, from those passed over. 'Tis a message for him as sees it and none other. Someone is in danger, he states boldly. Someone close to you is going to die, and there's not a thing you or anyone else can do about it. Kai opens his mouth to argue further with the man, but a coldness has gripped his heart. He knows the superstition well enough, and he knows what he saw. He is tempted to retort that there is no one close to him any longer, that death has already claimed the woman he loved. And then he remembers Morgana, and a fresh pain stabs through his heart, as keen and as agonising as anything he felt for Katrin. Morgana. He runs. He runs so hard and so fast that even Bracken is left trailing behind him. He runs though the air sears his lungs and his chest might burst from the effort. He runs though the muscles in his legs scream and his head becomes giddy from the doing of it. His hat flies from his head, but he does not pause to retrieve it. He can think only of Morgana, and that he has judged her harshly. He sees now that it is unfair of him to take against her strange ways. They have always been a part of her. He has simply been choosing to ignore them. How can she be to blame for that? The realization comes to him that he does not care, not about magic or mystery or things he cannot explain. He cares only about her, Morgana, with all her wildness and her curious gifts. Such talents as she has cannot be bad, he reasons, because they are part of her and she is a good person. He is certain of that. Why should these gifts not be godsend after all? The thought that she might be in danger, that something might happen to her before he can reach her, drives him on. He runs until at last he can see Fionn Lass, and then he runs harder up the drive, past the pond meadow and into the house itself, flinging wide the front door. He all but collides with Morgana as she emerges from the parlour. Standing in the hall, panting, fighting for breath so that he can speak, he grips the startled girl by the shoulders. Morgana, Morgana, you're all right, oh thank God, thank God! With one more gulp of air to sustain him, he pulls her close, pressing his mouth over hers, kissing her with the passion and longing of a man starved of love for a very long time. A man who has only just realised what he has. A man shaken by the fear that he might lose what he has finally found. He stops kissing her, but does not loosen his hold on her. Mrs. Jones has come out of the kitchen and is staring at him in astonishment, but he doesn't care. Morgana looks shocked. He tries to explain, gabbling on about the toily and the old man in the hedge, making no sense at all. In the end, he gives up and pulls her close, kissing her again, this time more slowly with less desperation, savouring the moment. When she pulls back, it is to look at him, questioning still, her expression uncertain. Kai smiles and says gently, "Well, at least you didn't bite me this time. I call that progress, my wild man."